Today we're going to talk about family and the effect that family, however conscious we've been, has had on us as people. Whose idea was the whole thing about family anyway? Well, family is God's idea. God's plan for family is man and a woman married for life. Extended family unified in submission to God. And so that word submission catches people a little bit awkwardly, but it's really, since it's his idea, then am I searching for what that looks like to carry out that idea on his terms? So the family is where we learn about life. We learn about values. We learn about God. And we learn about relationships. In the family we grew up in, our parents taught us how to relate to others. And just an aside, just a side note, and this will come into play a little bit later, but our parents are the truth holders. What does that mean? Well, even though children may disagree with what moms and dads have to say, they are stuck with the words, attitude, models of what life is about. That's why traditions are very critical. The repetition of certain things. Now that's great if it's about Thanksgiving, but there's also repetition and behavioral repetitions that are negative, and some of those things we, of course, left home with. Sir Thomas More, in his work Utopia, noted that newborn chickens attach themselves to the first living animal they were exposed to, even if it wasn't a chicken. So Steve, are you giving a lecture to somebody else? Why are we talking about chickens? Well, we're going to get to that in a second here. So at the same time, Australian zoologist Conrad Lorenz popularized this phenomenon in his work with geese. He found that during the first few years of life, baby geese would attach themselves to and follow the first thing they were exposed to. Lorenz called this imprinting. Imprinting might be defined as deeply entrenched learning that occurs during the critical period of development. And this work, just as an aside, was carried over by Bowlby, who developed attachment theory. And so his work wasn't about chickens. His work was about relationships with human beings, how to attach. We learn to connect in our relationships with our parents. And that connection is made with, if you look at the book at the side, How We Love, it's Monica K. Yerkovich borrowed the concept of imprinting to illustrate the critical role of parents. The high level and oft truth, we learn how to relate to others in our relationships with our parents. They suggest we learn our love styles in our relationship with our parents. They highlight the critical role of touch and listening. And so imprinting by the Yerkovich's model, as you get into the book, it's a powerful work. I'd suggest you read it. But the imprints are titled different things. So out of our parents' worlds comes the pleaser or the avoider. And these imprints are what we've learned to do to guard ourselves. I'm going to look at that guarding in a few minutes. Did you have at least one parent that listened and helped you talk about what was upsetting you? Some of us did okay at this when our children were little, but it wasn't always easy to continue this practice as our children matured. Monica K. Yerkovich referenced a survey that found that 75% of all adults did not have a single memory of being comforted by a parent. As parents, most of us asked questions of our child's behavior. Our child's behavior was an issue. Did you clean your room? Who ate the ice cream? Parents who are good listeners ask questions so they can understand what is going on in their children's hearts and minds. Although there's nothing wrong with asking our child if they cleaned their room, how often did we ask questions like, oh, you look sad. What's bothering you? When a parent listens to a child and asks questions, the child has an opportunity to reflect on and put words to what's happening inside them. You might have an adult-to-an-adult conversation that includes that. Wow, are you bothered by something? Your face looks like you're hurt. So our children learn as we reflect back and mirror back to them how to describe and identify feelings that are going on inside them. Now, we know that God knows all things. So why did God ask Adam, where are you, after he sinned in Genesis 3:9? Knowing that Cain was planning to murder Abel, why did he ask Cain, why do you look sad, in Genesis 4:6? Loving questions from a parent help the child develop an awareness of their feelings, thoughts, and sinful nature. This process ultimately gives us the ability to understand our reactions, behaviors, and needs, and inner conflicts as an adult. Most of us did the best we could as parents. Let's look at an ideal parent-child interaction. So the child expresses something. And when the child expresses their feeling freely without being shamed or limited, that makes them feel confident. So then, once they've done that, the parent recognizes and accepts that feeling. The parent then is able to respond to this child's needs once those feelings are on the table. The parent comforts if the child is distressed. Consequently, the child feels loved, safe, heard, and seen. The idea is that the more the child experiences this type of interaction with their parents, the more likely the child will develop a healthy self-view and interpersonal skills. Mollett and K. Yurkovich call this the secure connector imprint.
Listen, I just spoken with your grandmother. And I'm staying. For good.
I'm sorry, I was so horrible.
Don't worry.
It's just, I thought she'd always be here.
So did I. But in fact, she is, because she's on every page of your imagination. You'll always have her there, always.
But why did she have to die?
I don't know, boy. When I think of your mother, I will always remember how happy she looked, sitting there in the parlor, watching her play about her family, about her boys that never grew up. She went to Neverland. And you can visit her anytime you like. If you just go there yourself.
How?
By believing, Peter. Just believe.
So we're going to talk about your history, how you became you. You're a complex, indecipherable product of the unseen person God made you, We hopefully saw a little bit of that when we took the Myers-Briggs. Your genetic makeup, what do you bring to the table based on what you know about your family's history? Could be athletics, could be good looks. And then your experiences growing up in your family. All of these things affect how you become you. So we're going to talk about self-esteem. The word esteem can be defined as view. So we all have a self-view or self-esteem. This is the way you see yourself, although we are typically not likely to let others know this view. We usually talk about two types of self-esteem. There's low esteem and high esteem. These are often products of listening, comparing to others, social media, or simply a product of our sin nature. I would like you to consider a third type of self-esteem, and that's, are you accurate in your assessment? So these first two, high esteem, low esteem, are really self-made kinds of esteem. The Bible talks about how we should think about ourselves. Do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. And one of the things about ourselves or self-esteem is that it needs to be connected to our purpose. Scripture talks about in Psalms, "For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before there was one of them." So do we hear what that is really trying to say is that God knew you uniquely and wonderfully made, but he also had planned for you before your birth a way of life, a direction in life that were preordained before your birth. Scripture says, "As for me." Now scripture is talking about Daniel here. And Daniel now is talking to Nebuchadnezzar, and he is going to interpret his dream and the interpretation of the dream. And he's telling Nebuchadnezzar, "Before I tell you the dream," he says to him, "as for me, this mystery has been revealed to me, not because I have greater wisdom than anyone else alive, but so that your majesty may know the interpretation and that you may understand what went through your mind." Is this amazing that Daniel takes no credit for the gift he's been given? He's just a vessel. He's just a vessel. There's another example related to the building of the temple. And there was a person chosen to help assist in building the temple. And it says that I have filled him with the Spirit of God, with wisdom, with understanding, with knowledge, and with all kinds of skills to make artistic design for work in gold, silver, and bronze. Do you believe that applies to you before you were born, that God has a gift that he wants to give to you that he will instill in you by his Spirit, and we don't have to run after that or try to figure it out if we are sensitive to what God has for us? So self-esteem, there's two halves of the issue of esteem that we need to weigh together, and there's, of course, some conflicts of these two parts of us. Number one is that we are a child of God. We are kings and priests, righteous, holy, and wonderfully made. At the same time, we are evil and sick and sinful and incapable of good and unworthy. Which side of those, by the way, and again, without overkill on either side, are you balanced of an understanding that both are true and they don't disqualify you or overqualify you? How did we become ourselves? So as I explained in the first session, this time is going to be spent helping us see what should have been a normal, healthy relationship experience as a child, and how for most of us, we didn't have it. Therefore, we should expect that any relationship you entered would be difficult to manage or succeed in, no matter how determined or hard you tried. So here we have. as hard as you may. So one of the determinations that you decided, and me as well, actually, was telling myself that I am never going to be like my mom and dad. 6 months into my marriage, I saw all the things that I told myself I would never be, and I decided to go to counseling at that time. My wife said, I'm not going. She said she wasn't going to go. I said, it's not you, it's me. All the things I told myself I would never be, you're experiencing him. As a child, typically behaviors precede feelings. What does that mean? Emotions tell each of us where we begin and end. They help us establish boundaries in a relationship. They help me know what you're feeling and give me a chance to care for you. So if I step on your foot, you'll likely say ouch, and that makes perfect sense to me because I would say ouch when you step on my foot. When people step on my emotional feet, they can't see that, but I still need to say ouch. That is, that hurt me. I'm sad. That makes me happy. So what we need to understand about feelings is that my feelings are me. They tell you where I begin and end. So if I'm not expressing what those feelings look like, you have no idea. You have no idea the impact you've had on me. One of the things we understand about feelings, two or three things, is that feelings aren't right or wrong. If I step on your foot and you say, ouch, I wouldn't ask what's wrong with you. But as a child, when we cry or get upset about the little things, someone may ask us, what's wrong with you? And of course, we take that in, especially when it may be a parent that says it. And once again, to the child, the parent is the truth holder. And we'll look at that more deeply as we go. As well, feelings aren't negotiable. People I share my feelings with might respond by saying, don't let that bother you. You're taking things way too seriously. Lighten up and start being happy. Well, who gets to decide what is bothering me? The next time you step on their foot, tell them, lighten up and just be happy. So feelings aren't negotiable because I'm not negotiable. Who I am and how I feel is made by God, the way I'm wired, and feelings were part of that. So when life happened on the playground of life and someone at school hurt you or wouldn't let you play with them or you got a bad grade, could you go home and share these experiences with your mom and dad? If something happened in your home that made you feel upset or hurt, mom and dad were fighting and causing you pain, were you free to share that with them as well? Our greatest fear is not to belong or loved. So if the response to anything I might have asked got a reaction that was negative while we tried to share our feelings, we get to feel rejection. How I feel is me, and so any pushback on my feelings are something is wrong with me. Something is wrong with my question that I'm asking. Something's wrong with how I'm feeling about what's going on around me. So the greatest fears are not to belong or be loved. All of us are terrified of that, being alone, disconnected, unattached. So because of that, instead of sharing what we really feel, we learn to mirror our environment's expectation. So I'm sharing what I've been waiting to say to someone, because I've had to mirror those expectations. And when I go to share those things, I may have an outburst, and so I get to feel guilty about what I've said. Because if I'm going to mirror those environments' expectations and we stuff our feelings, then negative things begin to happen. And what we conclude is that I can't be the real me. I can't say what's really on my mind. And so over and over in the repetition of stuffing my feelings, stuffing my feelings, stuffing my feelings, something is going to happen, and most likely it's going to be some outbreak of anger. I feel frustrated. And then, of course, because I'm angry and I'm a Christian and I love the person that I got mad at and I have a lot of anxiety, then I get to feel guilty. I get to feel guilty for what I just did. All because that's how I've learned to share my feelings, because having tried to do that earlier and sooner was not successful. And so we stuff ourselves. Well, in the meantime, what's happening is that my self-confidence is being affected or infected by the success of this process. And so let's say by now you believe you're worth about a 3. Nobody really loves me, and if they knew who I really was, because I can't be the real me, they probably wouldn't want me to be around. Well, at work, let's say that somebody wants to tell you how nice you look. And of course, unless we think that's against sexual harassment rules, they want to tell you how nice you look. And because you're only worthy of being treated like a 3 and you don't trust those 8s, then you might tell them that there's a tear they can't see and a cousin gave you the dress and it's 2 years old, all because if they knew who you really were, kind of thing. They know who you really are, and how you dress has nothing to do with who you really are. One of the other examples of low self-esteem is if someone you're at work with asks you if you want some help, and you tell them, no, I'm okay. And 20 times later, they're gonna stop asking you because they believe you are okay. And then when they stop asking you if you need help, you get to feel like they don't care. What might a person decide if they believe they had no purpose, no belonging, no hope? Well, ultimately, it could get down to deciding that I'm not worthy of living. I'm not worthy of anyone's attention. I'm not worthy of connecting, and I'll just check out. So these are the things you need to look for when you're caring for people as a care coach: words and verbiage that sound like hopelessness and helplessness. So over time, being suppressed, and then we are repressed, not being able to be ourselves. Ultimately, that could lead to being depressed at some level. No one can always say when they are hurt with every person. However, when it's a way of life, we're in trouble. How free are you to share your feelings and needs with other people when they hurt you or you need help? How free are you with each other to share when you feel hurt by each other or someone else? So you have homework this week, and you're going to reflect on the kinds of things we talked about today. How free were you to talk about how you felt? How comforted were you as a child? How comforted are you now as an adult? Can you go to your mate and tell them you're hurting and you feel overwhelmed, and would they just hold you? Will they just listen to you, or do you feel ashamed of needing those things and think you should be a person just bucks up? Your self-esteem, where does that come from? Are you esteemed because it says in 2 Corinthians 5:21 that he made him who knew no sin to become sin that we might become the righteousness of God? How confident are you of what God says about you? We'll see you next week.